Today we're going to be taking a look at the new Zimaboard 2. This is the second generation of Zimaboard from Icewell, the company that have already bought us the Zima Blade and Zima Cube. It's got an upgraded N150 CPU, faster RAM, a faster PCIe slot, and improved networking. In the box we've got the Zimaboard 2 in its own cardboard carrier, and an accessory pack. The Zimaboard's carrier has a flip top that can be removed and reused to hold the Zimaboard and two 2.5-inch drives. Then we've got the Zimaboard 2 in a protective plastic sleeve. The Zimaboard 2 feels like quite a step up from the original. It now has a cast aluminium casing that makes it feel like a much more solid and premium product. It's still passively cooled, so there aren't any fans or ventilation holes on the case. The accessory pack has a dual SATA cable and a multi-region power supply. This provides 12 volts and up to 3 amps. Size-wise, it's almost the same as the original. It's 1mm longer and 4mm thinner. You can't really tell that there's a difference in length, but it is noticeably thinner, and it feels a lot more solid and better built. The ports and interfaces are all very similar to the original, and they're also in the same place, but there are some differences. On the front, we've got the same mini display port, but then we've got improved dual 2.5GB networking ports, and beneath those are two USB 3.1 ports. Next to those is the power supply barrel jack input. On the side is a PCI Express 3.0x4 slot, which is an improvement over the 2.0x4 slot on the original. And then at the back of the board, we've still got two SATA ports, alongside a central power port. These are the same SATA 3.0 ports that can do up to 6 gigabits per second. I really like the look of the new aluminium case. Internally, there isn't much on the bottom of the board other than the CMOS battery and a clear CMOS button next to it. On the opposite side, the Zimaboard 2 has an improved 4-core Intel N150 CPU. This has the same number of cores as the original Celeron N3450 CPU, but they now boost up to 3.6 GHz instead of 2.2 GHz. It's also got 3 times the cache and 9 PCIe Gen 3 lanes instead of 6 Gen 2 lanes on the original. The top shell is quite thick, which is needed to give it good thermal capacity. It also has an improved integrated GPU, now with 24 execution units that boost up to 1 GHz over the original 12. Storage remains the same, we've got 32 gigs of eMMC storage, and RAM stays at 8 gigs, but it's now DDR5 instead of DDR4, and it runs at an increased 4800 megatransfers per second. Both are soldered to the board, and therefore aren't upgradable. The Zimaboard 2 is designed to be run headless, so all you need to connect to it is the power supply and an Ethernet cable. You'll need to use a wired connection, as similar to the original, the Zimaboard 2 doesn't have Wi-Fi. After giving it a few minutes to boot up, we can log into our Zimaboard 2 by entering its IP address into a browser on the same network. It looks like it's been preloaded with the Zima Cube's version of the OS. This will probably be changed through a software update after the Zimaboard 2's launch. You'll also need to create a local user account to access the dashboard. Icewell also have a tool called Zima Client, which allows you to scan your network for connected Zima devices to give you their IP addresses. It's a good idea to set up a static IP address for your Zimaboard on your network, so that it stays the same even after rebooting. The Zimaboard 2 comes preloaded with Icewell's CASA OS. Although it's called an OS, it's effectively a customized Docker interface that runs on Debian. It's geared towards building a homelab or personal cloud server. If you're familiar with CASA OS, the dashboard has been kept quite consistent for a few years now, and can easily be customized. Under system settings, the CPU is hardly being used, and we're only using 11% of our available RAM. We can open up an extended view through BTOP, and we can now see the load and temperature on individual CPU cores. We can also see more detailed memory and disk usage information, more detailed network information, and also see all of our active processes running. Under storage, we've currently got no additional disks installed, so we don't have any additional available storage. We can still use the available eMMC storage through the Files app though. Under General, we can change the CASA OS settings. Network gives us port and address information for our Zimaboard 2 both for local and remote access. Under Apps, we can either configure our own Docker applications or visit the App Store to install over 50 community-verified apps. These have all been pre-configured to run on Zima devices, so only require a single click to install, and then some basic setup to get them running. You can also create and run virtual machines. I'm going to use an Ubuntu virtual machine to run a stress test to load up the CPU. This will allow me to test the power consumption and the capacity of the passive heatsink. Before running the virtual machine, the Zimaboard 2 uses around 7 watts when idle at 3% utilization. With the virtual machine running, this goes up to 16 watts with a stress test at full CPU load. This is on the bare board without any additional drives, PCIe cards or peripherals attached to it. Thermally, the passive heatsink enclosure does quite well under full load. After 7 minutes, we're hovering around 70 degrees. The surface of the case is at 56 degrees in a 20 degree room, which is hot to touch. After 15 minutes, the CPU temperature has gone up to 77 degrees, and after half an hour, we're up to 87 degrees, with a surface temperature of 68. After 41 minutes, we start hitting 90 degrees, which is where I stopped the test. The temperature dropped back down quite quickly once the stress test was stopped. So provided you're not subjecting the Zimaboard 2 to a full load for long periods of time, the passive heatsink works quite well, and it's great that it's silent. If it is more heavily loaded, then you'll probably want to add an external fan. I then printed out a 1U shelf for my home lab that holds the Zimaboard 2 along with a 2TB NVMe drive connected to the PCIe port and two 1TB 2.5-inch drives connected to the SATA ports. The Zimaboard 2 has 4 M3 threaded mounting points on the side, and I've used 2 of these to attach it to the shelf. Booting it back up, we can see our 3 recognized drives, 2 1TB SATA SSDs and our 2TB NVMe drive. I'm going to format the NVMe drive to use as standalone storage, and put the 2 SATA SSDs into a RAID 0 pool. These will just be used to store some movies and series for a Plex server, so I don't need any redundancy, but a single storage pool is quite handy to have. CusOS makes it really easy to set up drives and configure RAID arrays, even for inexperienced users. Once formatted, we can now see our 2 drives in the Files app, and we can start creating folders and uploading files to them. We can also see the drive and RAID array in the Storage tab, both having 2TB available. If we map these drives to our PC, then we can use the Zimaboard 2 as a NAS. On the NVMe drive, with a 1GB file, we get writes of a little under 240MB per second, and reads around 260. On the SATA array, we get similar speeds. Writes are around 230MB per second, and reads are also around 260. These speeds are what you'd expect for a 2.5GB network connection. CusOS also has some really cool features for a home lab. I quite like peer drop, which enables any device on your network with a browser to share files to any other device by going to the Zimaboard 2's IP address. You then open up peer drop, kind of like AirDrop on Apple devices, but without the Apple device limitation. I've just dropped this image to my PC from my iPhone. So that's an overview of the new Zimaboard 2. I think it's got a good set of upgraded features over the original, and it looks like a much more premium product. I particularly like that it's got dual 2.5GB networking built in, and the upgraded PCIe port makes it even more powerful to customize to fit into your home lab requirements. I'm not yet sure what the Zimaboard 2 is going to cost, but I guess somewhere around $180 to $240. If it's much more than that, it's going to have some stiff competition with other mini PCs on the market that offer similar performance and features. Let me know what you think of the new Zimaboard 2 in the comment section below, and if there's anything else you'd like me to test on it. Thanks for watching. Please remember to like this video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more tech and electronics projects, tutorials, and reviews.